A brilliant computer scientist, Tony Hoare, famously said in 2009 that he made a billion-dollar mistake by inventing the null reference. To quote Tony, "I call it my billion-dollar mistake. It was the invention of the null reference in 1965. This has led to innumerable errors, vulnerabilities, and system crashes, which have probably cost $1 billion of pain and damage in the last 40 years. I hate to say it, but I really agree with him. After working in industry for a while now, I think $1 billion is even undershooting the cost that a null reference has on existing software systems. Think about in Java all the times that you've run into null pointer exceptions when you were least expecting them or wanting to see them. Or in C, you'll get undefined behavior. Anything from a seg fault to actually writing to what would usually be address space zero. Null references and null pointers have caused programmers years and years of headaches. So, how does Kotlin fix that? Well, when Kotlin was first designed, the language has built-in compile time things that allow for null safety. This null safety allows us Kotlin programmers many fewer opportunities to run into things such as null pointer exceptions like we do in Java. Now, they aren't completely gone. There are still cases where you can see them, but they are significantly diminished compared to what you might have in older languages. So some of the things I'm going to cover are nullable types, the safe call operator, the Elvis operator, and also how you can enforce some null pointer exceptions when you really need them, such as the not null assertion operator. So the first one I want to talk about are nullable types. So I'm going to just call this nullable, and I'm going to call it a string like we normally do, and I'm going to say hello. And I'm lying right now, this type is not nullable. What that means is if I want to change the value of nullable to another string, that compiles. But if I want to change it to a value of null, you'll notice that IntelliJ is telling me I can't do this. Null cannot be a value for a non-null type string. So how do we fix this? Well, it's actually pretty simple. All you have to do is you add this little question mark, which indicates to Kotlin, hey, this could be a string or it could be a null. It's what's called a nullable type. And now this compiles. And what this also allows for is now the compiler can do some smarter checks on your code while it's compiling it to determine if you need to handle null or not. So what do I mean by that? Let's say that we don't have a nullable type just to start. And I want to print this string's length. So I'm gonna say nullable.length. So length is a property of the nullable string, and this should work because I know that my nullable is actually non-nullable right now. And this will work, and I don't need to check for whether I could be dereferencing a null pointer because I know that my variable right now is not nullable. And I get the value 5 here as expected. We'll see that if I try to change this to null, Kotlin won't even allow me to compile this code. In a language like Java, normally you could do this and it would compile, but then at runtime you would be getting that null pointer exception, which is a pain to deal with. Now here in Kotlin, when I turn this into a nullable type, now the compiler is going to give me an additional issue with this, and that is only safe or non-null asserted calls are allowed on a nullable receiver. Okay, so let's break that down for a second. So we're trying to get the length property out of our nullable now. So basically the compiler is telling us, hey, if you want to do that, you need to make sure that you're dealing with a non-null value here. The way that a lot of folks are used to doing this is they say, if nullable doesn't equal null, then I want to do something. And this is similar to what we're used to in a lot of other programming languages that have null references. You'll notice that now the compiler says, yeah, that's fine. So essentially, because the compiler knows that you're already checking for null up here, it knows you don't need to check for null here, therefore you don't need to do the safe operation like it was calling out earlier. But let's say you don't want to have to do this null check all the time. There is a way around that, and that is via this syntax right here. So this question mark indicates that I'm going to use a safe operation, and then I want to access the length property. So what this is going to do is this is going to say, hey, is nullable null? If it is, then I just want to return null again. If it's not null, then I want to return the associated length that it has here. So what IntelliJ is telling me right here is that it knows that nullable is always null. So if I print it out, we can see that we get null here. And then likewise, if I were to change this into hello, then we get 5. One other thing is that var types can be reassigned to a value. So that's where nullable makes a lot of sense. If the val type is used and the compiler already knows that your value is going to be null or not, then it's going to ask you, why are you indicating if this is nullable? Because you know that it is not nullable. But let's say you're writing some more complicated code and the compiler can't figure out whether it's going to be null or not, then that would be fine. But typically, a nullable type could be a var because you might be changing its value to a null reference later on. Another cool thing about safe calls is that they can be chained. So let's say that we've got a nullable list, which is going to be a list of strings, and I want that equal to a list of 1, null, and 3. So what this is saying is that the list itself could be nullable, and every single element within the list could also be nullable. So let's say I want to read out the properties of a few of the elements in this list. So I could do nullable list, use the safe call operator, and I want to get 0, but I don't know if the 0th element is null or not as well, so I'm going to use the safe call as well here, and then I'm going to get the string's length. And then I want to print that. So let's see how this looks. So in the nominal case where I am getting index 0, I get a string length of 3. If I want to get the first element and I rerun the code, we get null as expected. Now let's say that this whole list is null and we get null for that as well. Brilliant. So this is really powerful because normally what you'd have to do is you'd have to say, okay, is nullable list null? If it's not null, what's its size? All right, if I can get a certain element within the size that I want, is that element null? Instead, you can get a lot of that much more succinctly using nullable types with the safe call operator. The next thing I want to talk about is the Elvis operator. If I make this a little bit bigger, envision that I rotate this 90 degrees and this first character is the hair and this is the eyes. It has a striking resemblance to Elvis's characteristic hairstyle. That's why they call it the Elvis operator. You can think of it as a shorthand for ternary operators in other languages. So what you might be used to is you might say, if A is true, then you want to result in A, otherwise you might result in B. So if you're used to this sort of syntax, the Elvis operator looks like this, which basically just says, if A is Boolean, or in this case, if it is a non-null reference, then I'm going to use A. Otherwise, I'm going to use B. So let's do an example here. So let's make a variable called my var, and we'll call it a string, and we'll give it a value of hello again. And in this case, I want to print my var, and I'm going to use the Elvis operator, and then I'm going to say oops if my var is a null type. You'll notice that this is grayed out because IntelliJ is indicating to us that you can never hit the oops case because the Elvis operator will always return my var in this case. Let's run it and just double check that. And we can see we get hello here. Now, if we change this to a null and then we make this a nullable string, we'll see here that we print oops instead. This is really useful when you need to have default values to represent something when you're transforming data. Let's say I've got an integer here. I could just print oops if my integer doesn't have a value, and this all compiles like we would expect. We get a value of 1 when the integer value is present, and when it's not present, you get the oops value. You might think this is kind of similar to a Java optional or a similar type construct in other languages, and you'd be right thinking that. Essentially, the Elvis operator is a really nifty shorthand for a check on whether a condition is true, and then you return that condition or you return something else. The Elvis operator is essentially a really nice shorthand when you want to have a non-nullable value returned or you want some default value returned. Let's say the Elvis operator isn't good enough, and rather than having a default value, you want to error out when a nullable type is null. Well, Kotlin does have a way to do that too, and that is via the NOT NULL ASSERTION OPERATOR. So let's say I want to have a val called myVal, which is a non-nullable integer representing my var. So this isn't good enough because I'm just assigning a value over and this could be null. To fix that, I can use the NOT NULL ASSERTION OPERATOR, which basically says, hey, if this is null, then I'm going to throw an exception. Otherwise, if it's not null, I'm going to go ahead and give you the value and you can store it in a non-nullable type. And then we can print out my val. This works as expected when we have a non-null value in our myvar nullable. And then now if we add a null value, what we'll see is that we get this lovely null pointer exception here. And you might be asking, well, isn't this kind of getting back to the point that Tony got at with the $1 billion mistake of null pointer exceptions? And yeah, I would agree with that. I probably wouldn't use the NOT NULL ASSERTION OPERATOR all that often unless you had to have guarantees in your code that your nullables are not null. And at that point, I'd be asking, do you really need to use nullables or should you be using something else? But there are cases for using this, and it is a very useful part of the language, so use it wisely where it makes sense. On the topic of null pointer exceptions, another way that you can trigger a null pointer exception if you really want to is you could just throw one directly. This will throw a null pointer exception as well. Just like in Java, it's not usually typical to throw a null pointer exception yourself, and it's also not typical to catch null pointer exceptions in your code. Similarly, in Kotlin, you don't normally want to do this, but there is an option to do it in the one-off case where you might want to. I will say there are still other ways to introduce null pointer exceptions within Kotlin, mainly when you're interfacing very closely with Java, because you can't entirely get away from that when you're compiling the Kotlin code into bytecode along with the Java code, because there are some guarantees you don't get. But when you're writing pure Kotlin, it's a lot easier to avoid those null pointer exceptions, and that null safety built into the language is great. So that is how Kotlin avoided a $1 billion mistake in the context of computer programming. I think it's really cool that these modern languages are having more things that the compilers can do for us because, let's face it, null safety is a really important aspect of code, and it is the source of so many code vulnerabilities out there, and I'm really glad that we're seeing this here in languages like Kotlin. If you're familiar with Rust at all, you might see the parallels between forcing different logic branches when you have a good versus not good result to an operation, aka in the case of Kotlin, a nullable value which may or may not contain a null reference. If you enjoyed today's video, or if you learned something new, please do smash that like button. Thank you for watching. I really appreciate it. Have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.